Well, welcome and good evening, wonderful dice of all alignments. I am Lunar D8, and this is Let's Read Warhammer 40,000, Part 2. This time with me, more staying on topic. We'll be talking about the Angels of Death, Blood Angels, all those sorts of things that are part of the Emperor's forces in the Warhammer games. That being said, let me go on now. Click back on this so we have something interesting in the background for everyone. Just double check OBS to actually make sure it's recording. That is not the correct button. Everything looks fine. Looks like it's recording just fine. But unpause this so everyone can enjoy some nice background ambiance. Well, let's read about the Angel's Death. No greater symbol of imperial authority and military might exists than the Adeptus Starcase, known to much of the Imperium as the Space Marines, or simply the Angels of Death. These post-human warriors strike with speed, skill, and overwhelming force against the deadliest threats to the Emperor's realm. It is said that there are 1,000 chapters in Space Marines, and that each of those chapters consists of 1,000 loyal battle cars who stand ready to the Emperor's bidding. In a realm as vast and disjointed as the Imperium, it is impossible to make such statements, even the faintest one of surety. If this claim were true, however, it would mean that one space marine existed for every populated planet the Emperor's realm. It means it speaks volumes to the abilities of these superlative warriors that the wider Imperium believes this. Sufficient. The Space Marines act as a sword and shield. They strike from the heavens to shatter the armies and fastnesses of the armies. Fastnesses, you know? Okay. As often as they defend the worlds of the Imperium with unshakable determination, though their numbers are few, each Space Marine is supremely skilled combatant, whose body is enhanced with genetic alchemy, whose mind and soul are armored against fear, doubt, and despair. They are brutal, the finest work in the Imperium can provide, and make war with speed and ferocity few can match. To become a Space Marine is to become a living weapon. These warriors sacrifice much of their humanity in the name of protecting their species, leaving behind whatever existence they might otherwise have known in favor of endless war in the Emperor's name. In exchange, however, they become more than they could have ever been. And, unless death in battle takes them first, they may live to fight for centuries in mankind's service. Space Marines are organized into chapters, each of which is a self-contained and largely self-sufficient army with its own monotistic culture, massive culture, heraldry and traditions, and favorite tactics. Nearly every chapter rules over its own personal planet, from a fortified fortress monastery of vast size and power. Those that do not instead maintain crusading fleets that ply the darkness of the void and hunt always for the next threat to humanity. Almost all Space Marine chapters are led by a chapter master, a storied exemplar of both martial might and strategic brilliance, who wields greater power and autonomy even than a planetary governor. There is a great variation in culture, philosophy, and even physical characteristics between Space Marine chapters, yet still common threads run through them. These can be traced back to the Primarchs, the mighty demigod sons of the Emperor himself. It was from samples of their genetic material that the original Space Marine legions were created for the Great Crusade, and in accordance with doctrines of the Sacred Tome, known as the Codex Astartes. It was those legions that were broken down in myriad chapters. During the historic Second Battle, many, many, many more chapters have been created since in successive battles, and all have been created using the reserve stocks, the substance known as genes, which stems from the Primarchs of old. The most recent of these muscles was known as the Ultima Fountain, and it saw a new breed of Space Marines join the fight. Known as Primaris space marines, these mighty warriors fashioned vast numbers over 10,000 years by the Archmagus Call, one of the most skilled and obsessive of all the adeptus of Mechanicus Magna. Call based his works on information. Trying really hard not to go off track. I wanted to, but I'm going to keep myself in the game. The Adeptus Astartes continue to fight for man's life. Their arrival is time for the new. For never has mankind shown their descent to this degree. It remains to be seen, however, whether even such powerful warriors as these can tip the scales. There is no greater honor than to become a space marine. Few were offered the chance, few were still surviving. Most chapters recruit in the feral worlds. Hard, merciless plans breed hard and merciless warriors, after all. They set trials that only the young may attempt. These are brutal tests of skill, speed, and endurance. Strength, intellect, whatever each chapter believes, their aspirants need to be worthy. For those who pass the great pride. But in truth, the journey is only just the beginning. Next comes the surgery. Chapter Apothecaries, implanting organs grown in sacred cheeks. That is our heritage. Years those organs take to grow in the aspirant, developing as his body changes, becoming bigger, stronger, and more resilient than it could have ever been otherwise. Some do not survive this process. It is no small thing to send to the ranks of Adeptus Astartes. Those who do face the most arduous training, countless hours, psycho-indoctrination, and subconscious conditioning. A merciless, unending regimen of drills and tests and trials, at which still more will fall and will fail. Those who prevail earn the right to count themselves amongst our number, and only then does their true test begin. Brother Captain Archibald, Ultramarines Second Company, Zadarian Address. Warriors of the Faith, the Adeptus Aurelius and Sisters of Battle, as they are widely known throughout the Imperium, are the militant arm of the Ecclesiastes. To them falls the duty of defending the Imperial Faith from across all the Emperor's realm, purging heretics with bolt laid in flame, launching star-spanning crusades to drive back the darkness that ever threatens their home. Countless preachers, confessors, priests, and missionaries set out each year for the Imperium's cardinal worlds to spread the word of the Imperial faith. Their duty is to convert the heathen savages of fringe worlds, suborning their deviant belief systems, and bringing them into the light of the Emperor by whatever means necessary. They march in the Imperial armies, their booming rhetoric stoking the fires of faith in all loyal servants of the Emperor who hear them. They move amongst the teeming populations of Imperial worlds, join interstellar expeditions in the darkest reaches of the void, and ensure that more souls than every day offer their heartfelt prayers to the God Emperor of mankind. By comparison, the duty of the Adeptus Aurelius is singular. They look to the sanctity of the Imperial faith, striking swiftly and mercilessly to eradicate any threat to their creed. As the purveyors of the single state-mandated Imperial faith, it is unsurprising that the Adeptus Historum, commonly called the Ecclesiastery, possesses wealth beyond the wildest imaginings of the most covetous miser. When it comes to their armed forces, however, the Ministorum are anything but frugal. Armored battle chapels and vast, trans-atmospheric invasion cathedrals bear the battle sisters to war. They march out clad in power armor that bears many similarities to that of the Adeptus Astartes, and wielding an array of equally destructive firearms and melee weaponry, armored fighting vehicles, baroque combat walkers, and devastating mobile artillery support. Them on the field of war is all aspects of battle, from their rigorous training and preeminent spiritual purity to their potent materiel, that the Battle Sisters exemplify the strength of the Imperial faith and the fury of the God Emperor made manifest. Though, in theory, the Adeptus Aurelius, the weapon of the Ecclesiastes, In truth, the militant orders take their direction from the most senior of their number, the Absa Sectora. They are ruled from the convent, the Sirius of Terra, and the convent Sanctorum of Ophelia VII, with each Adeptus Oratoris order operating with its own armored sanctuaries and retaining responsibility for its own parish, the majority of which span entire sectors of the Imperium. The Sororitas orders, there are many different orders in the Adeptus Sororitas, and not all are directly concerned with armed conflict. The Order's Office of Dollar Princes provide medical support for Imperial forces in the field and work alongside organizations such as the Ordo Sororitas to halt the spread of supernatural maladies. The Order's Thumulus meanwhile act as advisors, majordomos, and diplomats to within the rare field strata of the Imperial High Society while providing the Ecclesiastes with eyes, ears, and if needs be, a concealed blade amidst the cut and thrust of courtly politics. Then there are the Order's Dialogus, the scholars and preceptors who labor long to translate and gain insight to the text wholly and heretical, or Xenos of nature. Still, the most widespread and well-known of all the Orders are militant. Divided into preceptories, commanderies, and missions, they wage wars from one end of the Imperium to the other. Organizations such as the Selfless Order of Our Martyred Lady, the Stoic Order of the Balanced Heart, and the Furious and Relentless Aggressive Order of the Bloody Rose, the Dedicated Perfectionists of the Order of the Abba Chalice, and many more have earned places of eternal honor across the Emperor's realm. The Inquisition. Few Imperial organizations are as shadowy in nature or as far-reaching in their power as the Ordos of the Inquisition. An Inquisitor has the authority to requisition whatever military or covert assets they require to complete their mission to deploy private armies at the will and even unleash ultimate sanction of exterminatus upon the worlds considered lost to damnation. The duty of the Inquisitors is no less than to ensure, through whatever means necessary, the ultimate survival of the Imperium itself. With such a weight upon their shoulders and such power in command, it is unsurprising these singular individuals are Machiavellian and utterly merciless. Many Inquisitors think nothing of mind wiping or executing entire regiments, garrisons, or even planetary populations if they believe they deem necessary. They act with the implicit authority of the Emperor's own hand. To deny them is death. The genetically encoded rosette that each Inquisitor carries amidst vermilion level clearance codes that leave no door locked against them and no asset beyond their reach. Those who know that the Inquisition exists at all pale at the very whisper of its name, and with good cause. The Inquisition is not a single organization, but rather is broken down into a vast number of bodies known as the Ordos. Each Ordo has its own focus and area of responsibility. Some are very broad, such as the witch-hunting Ordo Heretus, or the expert alien slayers, the Ordo Xenos. Others are smaller or more specialized. The Ordo Sanctorum, for instance, was founded to understand combat and supernatural diseases spread by the worshippers of the plague god Nerva. And the Ordo Chronos exists to conquer and swiftly neutralize contradictory time streams that are caused by the vagaries of warp travel. The Ordos Barbaras oversees pre-industrial human worlds and ensures they do not fall into deviant worship. The Ordo Sicarius monitors the deeds and operatives of the Officia Sanatoria, and there is even the Act of Narcos, whose purpose is shrouded in mystery, and an Ordo Vigilus that was founded solely to keep watch upon the Ordo Necros. Each Ordo varies enormously in size, though in truth many Inquisitorial. I'm terrible at talking. Operatives are so secretive in their ways that even the Ordos themselves believe that they can give no accurate accounting how many agents make up their ranks. Though groups of Inquisitors occasionally form like-minded conclaves, they more usually work alone, often on extended undercover missions. More than one Inquisitor has been declared long dead, only to reappear decades even centuries later, with their mission finally complete. By their very nature, Inquisitors are strong-willed, isolationists, and controlling individuals who rarely work well with others, with their peers. However, many do employ bands of hand-picked operatives whose particular skill, specialisms, or knowledge bases are deemed useful. These henchmen typically become fiercely loyal to their Inquisitor and vary enormously in nature. Law enforcement officers, warrior bodyguards, adepts, and savants of all sorts are common amongst Inquisitional editorial warbands. Stranger beings may also be seen, such as the Xenos mercenaries, sanctioned psychers, cult assassins, and countless other unusual and deadly operatives. Such operatives work in the shadows of the Inquisitor's behalf until he or she deems it time to unleash overt military force. Even within the Order, there are vastly different schools of thought, so much so that it is not uncommon for different orders or individual Inquisitors to engage in silent wars with one another through the shadows of the Imperial worlds. Most common divisions lie between the Inquisitors described as Puritan, those who cleave to the absolute letter of the Order's law and operate within fiercely conservative parameters, and the Radicals, who view the tools, technology, and lore of the Imperial's enemies as tools to be used for humanity's gain. Inquisitors reach such positions by degree, and may move one school of thought together during their years of toil against the darkest horrors of the past. One thing is always true. The longer an Inquisitor fights for the Imperium, and the more they learn the threats they face, and the terrifying consequences of failure, the more extreme their methods become, and the harder it gets them to serve right and wrong. The Ordo Heretics, grim and relentless, are the witch hunters of the Ordo Heretics. To them follows the duty of tracking down rogue psychers and subjecting them to the Emperor's justice. This is a perilous task. Their quarry exhibit dark and unnatural powers, from the casting of mutating hexes, but conjuring of witch fire to mind control, telekinesis, or bewildering illusion. The Ordo Heretics employ an army of devices to counteract these malign perils, from arcane psycho columns that track psychic score to thrugals of holy incense, blessed stake launchers, and potent null rods that choke off the abilities of nearby psychers. Puritan witch hunters are infamous for lashing even the most minor psychers or even suspected mutants to their putrefying pyres. While the Ordo Heretics radicals tend to exhibit psychic abilities of their own, meeting the foul conjurations of unsanctioned witches with righteous manifestations of the Emperor's might. The Order Malleus are the Emperor's Daemon Hunters. It is their appointed task to purge the chaos cults that lurk within the Imperial Society before their forbidden worshipping leads to a demonic breach. Should the Ordo Malleus be too late to stop such a catastrophe, they must face the resultant tide of horror and close the rift at any cost. The Ordo Malleus Inquisitors tend to be accomplished warriors of immense spiritual fortitude and often go to war clad in sanctified armor, wielding blessed weapons, and extremists they may be called the Aid of the Grey Knights, a chapter of demon-hunting space marines whose existence is a guarded secret. The Ordo Malleus are no strangers to concealing forbidden lore. They stop at nothing to keep the existence of demons a secret from the wider Imperium, and think nothing of mind-wiping or purging armies and populations wholesale to do so. The Ordo Xenos study, exploit, and eradicate the alien. Most Ordo Xenos Inquisitors dedicate their lives to combating a single species above all else, for there are as many different races in the galaxy as there are stars, and no one being can hope to battle them all. Both Puritan and Radical Ordo Xenos Inquisitors seek to learn all they can from their prey. Studying examples of alien technology and lore, dissecting them where possible, Puritans draw the line at disgust and comprehension, using the knowledge they have gained to better exterminate the species in which they specialize. Radicals seek ways to integrate the Xeno secrets into their war gear and doctrines, even employing retinues of alien mercenaries and cultivating contacts within their societies. All work toward the same goal, however, elimination of the alien threat, and the eventual galactic supremacy of humanity. Perils of the Imperium is the largest and most powerful empire to span the stars since the days of the Necronosphere warred with the ancient Eldari. The immensity of the Emperor's realm, vast resources and marital power, yet it also brings humanity into conflict with countless enemies and ensures that every sector of the Imperium knows constant danger. No official cartographs make the borders of the Imperial state clearly defined and secure. True, they are in constant flux. Even the segmented solar is not as unified, as stable, as a human heartland as the administration would have their subjects believe. While the further one travels from Holy Terra, the more rapidly Imperial space wild dangers. But with vast regions outside human control, the far-flung borders of such regions as the Halo Stars, the Veiled Region, and the Western Fringe are the wildest of all, with worlds falling to invasion and turning traitor as quickly as the new planets can be claimed and settled by the rapacious exploratory fleets and daring rogue traders. Those loyal to the Imperium huddle behind their battlements and stare out at the dark void beyond, ever wary of the myriad perils that lie in wait in the darkness between the stars. For most of it is less a question of if some terrible threat will descend upon this world, as when it will arrive, that monstrous form. It will take what it does. Countless enemies lurk beyond the nominal borders of the Imperium, gathering their strength, choosing their moment of strength. The chaos-serving heretic perspectives are chief amongst the malevolent foes, turncoat spacemen who rule over their own empires in the name of the Dark Gods, and descend upon the Emperor's realm to leap and plunder at will. Some ride the empiric tides of the onrushing warp storm, while others launch piratical raids or gather together into an immense invasion fleet, commanded by some suitably powerful warlord. The most devastating examples of the latter have been the 13 Black Crusades of Abaddon, the Despoiler, which, between them, the shattered linchpins of reality itself. Some say herald the Great Opening, no great thing. Xenos threats, beyond number, also surround the Imperium. On every side, humanity encounters strange and inimical species every day. For the mind-stealing enslavers and the chromatic prude to the throne of the Gore, some creatures are indigenous to a single world. Many more are barely above the level of predatory beasts or parasitic organisms, dangerous certainly, but not on a grand scale. More threatened by far the Xenos species, whose territory empires span star systems, and whose borders clash violently with those of the Imperium. The expansionist Tau Empire presses aggressively into the Imperium's eastern reaches. Barbarous orc invasions crash like bloody waves against the bulwarks of humanity's defenses. Time and time again, Necron tomb worlds awaken, often beneath the feet of horrified Imperial settlers, and their invasion fleets sweep down from space to swat aside humanity's defenses with arrogant ease and eradicate the Emperor's servants like vermin. Tyranid splinter fleets push into the galaxy from every side, writhing through the darkness like tendrils of some immense beast, and scourging all organic life that lies in their path. Meanwhile, new Xenos threats arise all the time, fresh and monstrous terrors emerging from the darkness beyond the Imperium's borders, plunging human worlds into anarchy and apocalypse. Space hulks. Space travel is unforgiving, littered with hazards that can stare the unwary and the unfortunate alike. Malfunctions, mutinies, boarding actions, and warp anomalies leave many ships dead and adrift upon the currents of the Imperium. The vastness of space and the perils of war ensure few of these wrecks are ever salvaged. Instead, the lifeless vessels drift aimlessly, a sea of derelicts moved by eddies until they are swallowed further by warp storms. These colossal tempests crush together the wrecks of warships, space stations, trade haulers, colony craft, and debris, and creating vast agglomerations known to the Imperium as the Space Hulks. Some of these twisted ghost ships are little larger than a single macro large deep bulk hull, void hull. Others are more akin to roaming planetoids of wreckage, their insides an endless maze-like honeycomb of tangled passages, chambers, crawl spaces, conduits, biodomes, and hangars, full of shifting shadow and hidden technology treasures. Space hulks are carried upon the tides of the warp and then spat out in real space, often drifting ominously through entire settled systems, often before blinking away once again. They are regarded by the Imperium as harbingers of dire omen, not least because their creaking hulks often play host to inimical forces, warbands of chaos worship, or vast tribes of orcs, often claim space hulks as invasion craft, while the most united emerge in the real space saturated with warp energy and heaving the demonic entities. More still are infested by Xenos predators and lethal tyrannid vanguard organisms that must be destroyed by the Imperial boarding parties before they spread their taint to the nearby warps. The enemy within. Countless perils lurk in the bounds of the Emperor's realm. The hardship of daily life plants seeds of resentment and rebellion in minds made fertile through suffering, mutant monsters, and concealed foes stalk the shadows. The ravings of twisted demagogues lead the faithful into damnation. Against these threats, humanity must be ever vigilant. For all the unholy threats prowling beyond the frail light of the Imperial civilization, many believe that it is the darkness lurking within the civilization itself that presents the greatest danger of the Emperor's realm. From twisted instabilities and unnatural deviance to demon-worshipping cults, tech heresy and xenophile traitors, the myriad enemies rise from amongst the human herd with every passing day. Piracy and sedition are a constant threat, of course, and the rule of the Imperial law is harsh, and many are unwilling to exist within its strictures. Even without the corrosive effects of chaos worship and full-blown heresy, many ship captains, astro-militarian regiments, and planetary governors give in to the lure of disloyalty. With every passing year, their punishment may be slow in coming, for the Imperium is lumbering and monolithic. It is always comes eventually. However, the sentence is invariably death. Mutation is another widespread scourge that lurks in the dark corners of the countless Imperial colonies, outposts, hive cities, and industrial sprawls. It causes our myriad industrial runoff and toxic environs. Itinerant generations exposed to strange planetary conditions, alien radiation, and simple genetic deviation, or most insidious of all, the warping influence of chaos. This last has become a more pressing danger than ever since the opening of the Great Rift, and it is at the heart of why the Imperium is almost entirely intolerant of mutation, while useful strains of abhumans, such as the Augurids, the Rattlings, or the Navigators, were officially sanctioned. The curse of mutation is normally met with violent abhorrence, lest such rampant deviance be a sign of dangerous warp taint. The people of the Imperium are taught to hate, fear, and revile. And failure to report such abominations is considered tantamount to heresy. Of course, such a culture of intolerance serves to drive vast numbers of otherwise saved and loyal abhumans to desperate measures, and has ushered countless lost souls into the arms of the Dark Gods over the millennium. In an era of such all-pervading war, however, the Imperium can ill afford the weakness of mercy. Not all heretics are mutants, though. Amidst the grinding misery of the dystopian Imperium, there are countless reasons that a human soul might turn to worship chaos. Some seek release from lives of slavery, poverty, and hopeless, and endless toil. Others desire power, influence, whether to provide for those who depend upon them, or to have revenge themselves upon those who have oppressed and mistreated them. You who followed the honey promises of drunk gods truly start out as evil. However, it is a slippery slope of morally compromising choices that lead from desperation or idealistic recidivism to full-blown heresy. Cults beyond number gather in the dark corners of the hive cities to worship deities. Primitive priests work forbidden blood rites upon frontier worlds. Imperial nobles fall to hedonistic pleasure sets, while twisted misinterpretations of the Imperial scripture lead unwitting practitioners into the summoning rituals that can damn worlds. The Psyker's Curse. Psykers are among most dangerous mutants amongst the human herd. These individuals can touch upon the warp with their minds, channeling its energies to reshape reality. Some can conjure blasts of fire or glean glimpses in the future. Others gain the ability to alter your memories. Their physical appearance or transfer, hapless victims, the bloody ruin. The slightest thought, the most insidious, can read and influence the minds of others, manipulating their helpless puppets in the shadows, or rising up as twisted despots. Many of these abilities are useful to the Imperium. Psykers detected early by the black ships and subjected to the agonized soul-binding ritual are pressed into service as living weapons for Imperial agents. Yet for every Psyker being discovered and made safe, countless others slip from Imperial net. Those who understand and control their powers are dangerous enough. Worse are those who do not and cannot. When frightened or angry, such Psyker's abilities manifest out of their control. Moreover, their minds burn like lanterns amidst the turbulent tides of the water. Demonic entities are drawn to such witch sites, circling like predators looking for the slightest chink in their prey's defenses. Throughout whispered blandishments, nightmarish visions, or simple brute force, a demon may be able to possess an unprotected Psyker. The most powerful entities can push out through the Psyker's mind and body as though forcing a passage through a weak point in the defense wall. Not only are the results horrific for the victim, but entire demonic invasions can pour through such breaches. So can a single unguarded thought or ill-understood nightmare damn a world. The Dark Gods. The gods of chaos dwell within the endless and infinitely mutable realm of the warp. The ancient entities of unimaginable power and infinite malice. They look upon real space with covetous eyes and scheme endlessly for its overthrow. There are four of these monstrous beings, each an exemplar of mortal obsessions and fear, each certain that they alone should rule. In the warp, similar thoughts and emotions gather like rivulets of water. They form streams and eddies of anguish and desire, pools of hatred and torrents of pride. Since the dawn of time, these tides flow through the warp. Such is their power, that they form creatures made of the very stuff of dreams and nightmares. Eventually, these instinctual, formless beings gain a rudimentary consciousness. The chaos gods of the warp. Vast psychic pressures made from the fantasies and horrors of mortals. As the races of the galaxy prospered and grew, so did their hopes and dreams. Their rage and wars, their love and hatred. This burgeoning flood of raw emotion fed menacing chaos gods and nurtured their unholy power. Eventually, the gods reached back to their market makers and into through the dreams of mortals, soon seeing the fruits of their labors. They began an eternal venture to influence the physical realm and its myriad races. A chaos god grows in power through the actions and thoughts of mortals. Those who worship such a dark god and behave in a way that feeds it are rewarded with a strange gift, extraordinary power, and potential immortality. The chaos gods battle one another constantly in war, hurling endless armies and their demonic followers in conflict. Across the river of ever-changing hellscapes, the realm of chaos, so too do their mortal followers make war across real space, fighting always to further the goals of their patron deity, in the hope that their rewards will elevate
greater power. Korn is the blood god, embodying battle, bloodshed, and senseless rage. His followers depict him most commonly as a towering and monstrous warrior clad in brazen armor, seated upon an immense throne of brass, sat atop a mountain of trillions of mortal skulls. Korn's head is styled as that of a bestial warhound, from whose nostrils spurt smoke and flame, whose grotesque features are half hidden by a skull-like helm. His feet are pictured as cloven hooves. His eyes are fiery crimson pits of the deepest and most tense hatred imaginable. At Korn's side is shown the greatest and most destructive sword ever created, known across the galaxy as the Woebringer, War Maker, and the End of All Things. It is said that when Korn swings his titanic blade, he can hack apart the stuff of reality itself, allowing his frenzied demon legions to spill forth. It is the creed of Korn's worshippers that he desires eternal war and endless bloodshed. He cares not whether it is his own warriors or those the enemies who bleed, only that blood continues to flow. The Lord of Battle's wrath is infinite. They say his hatred and bloodlust are utterly unquenchable. His temple is the battlefield. His altar is his blazing trench, bloodied arena, and shell-blasted city. All who make war worship Korn by their deeds, whether they intend to or not. In this age of ceaseless galactic conflict, the Blood God has grown mighty indeed. Tzenetik, known by such titles as the Changer of the Ways, the Great Sorcerer, and the Architect of Fate. Tzenetik is the patron deity of change, destiny, an unbound sorcerer. His worshippers empower their god through the manipulation and politicking of the desire for continual change and reshaping of reality. Depicted as ever-shifting being, whose flesh crawls with laughing, whispering, sobbing, prophesying, lying faces, Tzenetik is shown proud by sweeping horns, wreathed in arcane fire, and surrounded by nebulae of magical energies, which twist and change to show those places and people upon whose fate the deity muses. Tzenetik's worshippers knows that he plans of his own, schemes insane, labyrinthine complexity, fit driving in the most ferociously intelligent mortal minds and madness. The change god's servants labor constantly to fulfill his ineffable thoughts, and their purpose and deeds often seem like utter lunacy to their enemies until the precise moment that they come to spectacular and bloody fruition. Nurgle. Grandfather Nurgle is said to be as generous as he is malignant, for he is the source of every disease, pestilence, parasite, and epidemic to ever trouble mortal beings. Nurgle is rarely described as a spiteful demon. Rather, he sees his plagues as gifts, given freely so as to maintain the endless cocoon cycle of death, decay, and unbound life that follows in his wake. He is commonly depicted as a vast hulk of rotting, parasite-riddled flesh, through which an infinite number of diseases and vast swarms of plague-like mites run rampant. His royal pop skins leathery, while the bloated innards that spill its rents are said to give off a stench that can rot reality itself. Nurgle is depicted hunched over his cauldron of poxes, humming cheerfully to himself as he brews up another infectious concoction with which to bless the mortal races of real space. The Plague God's realm within the Immaterium is depicted as a monstrous garden of unimaginable foulness and rampant life. Amongst voided swamps and bloated plant life, his demons gamble and trudge, and the land itself can spill through into real space when enough disease and entropy and misery is concentrated enough upon a single point. Nurgle's power fluctuates the most of all the chaos gods. At its apex, its metaphysical epidemics ravage the stars, only to fall into remission when the tides of sickness burn themselves out. Yet he rises again with entropy up to last year. Slanesh is the dark prince that hideously beautifully embodies the excess in all its many forms. He is the power of endless temptation, of even the most virtuous beginnings, transformed and perverted into hideous vice, arrogance, lust, greed, sadism, desire, ambition, all serve the deep dark prince's power. Kind of sounds like the introduction of the Mega Man Legends game. You guys know that. It's like the scrolling text like Star Wars when the Flutter's going to that first dungeon in the very first Mega Man Legends game. Reminds me of that. All serve to feed the Dark Prince's power. Yet so, too does any excessive love, generosity, determination, or pride. In short, as soon as a mortal being's efforts pass into the realm of obsession, they give worship to Slaanesh, however inadvertently. Depictions of Slaanesh vary depending upon what speaks loudest to the worshipper's hidden desires. The Dark Prince is most often described in human lore as androgynous and listless, guileless and your innocent, yet with eyes that instantly steal the soul. Who dares the enter? Slaanesh's domain within the realm of chaos is said to be a vast palace of pleasure that resides in the heart of six concentric circles of temptation. Each of these perverse realms appears at first glance to be a paradise devoted to a different mortal desire, be it vain glory, gluttony, lust, sloth, or any other obsession. Yet in truth, each is a hellish snare intended to waylay those who invade the Dark Prince's territory and trap them forever in torments of their own making.
Saga of Imperius. The Emperor's Wrath is a fortress forged of blood and foam, of fire and ire and courage and hate. Its walls of corpses of martyrs blood. Carrion mountains rise up the hills. The last remains of its myriad foes, the dust of time itself. Neither can tell this endless edifice the Imperium stands eternal. Ages of mankind, the road of the human race is walked through heaven. History stretches long and bloody at their collective heels. Its origins are hidden by the twisting and swirling dust of aeons, its present wreath in the flames of war, and ahead of the future yawns in the dark and forbidding pit. Still, Imperial instaurators do what they can to preserve the truth of humanity's journey, even if none may survive to read it. Beneath the Imperial Palace on Terra lie thousands of miles of catacombs, hushed vaults, and scroll-stuffed libraries. They are protected by rude, sealed bulkheads. I need water. I'll bring some water with me. I'm thirsty. Kind of surprised that one guy hasn't, like, opened this door at some point. Kind of figured that they would penalize the person staying in this hiding spot for too long. Guess you're gonna stay in here indefinitely if you don't care. Just assume no one's going to actually just be sitting here this long. And he's walked by a few times, so he comes in and out. So, you can hear him talk every time he comes by. They can endure sustained orbital bombardment. Their guardians are shadowy terrors, unsleeping ever vigilant, so vast is their sprawl that predatory things have evolved amidst the shadows of the dust. It sounds like a Doctor Who episode. Ruling over trammeled ecosystems of pallid, trunculate earth. The knowledge kept here unlocked spans the great age of the planet. Even this ultimate cosmos is molded and much eroded by entities that escape from touch. Yet those fragmented records are unending. It will take many lifetimes to study and contain the secrets of last greater sanity and bring entire period fragile down. It is well, perhaps, that you even know the endless archives' existence.
fewer still are permitted to be outdoors. The age of Terra, millennium 1 through 15. No record now remains of humanity's first altered steps in the altered understanding. That step forbidden, the confidence of skill, increasing those steps, became strides, became bounding leaps through space. Ancient Earth became the shining hub of a powerful human realm, with Mars, the first world terraform, standing proud as a bastion of technological innovation and scientific learning. Humanity's first encounters with alien races are not directly detailed, though fragments suggested a core to struck the sun, while wars were fought with others, most notably the ever-belligerent orcs. Little more can be said of this long-lost age of adventure hope. Glimpses and echoes of all this time. The age of technology, millennium 15 to millennium 25. The first indication of human warp travel date the millennium of this age, began at gruesome disasters and many setbacks. Yet it is clear that eventually technology was perfected. The cultivation of the navigator chain, the establishment of navigator houses came soon after, allowing vast leaps in interstellar travel, and the establishment of full-blown human empire amongst the stars. As humanity's power and influence grew, so did its hubris. The indomitable spirit of the human endeavor has ever risen to the sternest challenges. Interstellar exploration trained in inevitable war presented challenges that come from the time planetary colonization pursued at the ocean's rate. It seems like the network was able to erase the time again to war with power blocks and planetary fires, but nothing could reestablish human space as a whole. Human scientists and engineers, others, and innovators became new gods. They worked alien technologies and interfaces and devices to increase their efficacy and little thought to the risk. They modified their spaces, genome, to ever greater degrees, fashioning vast armies of tailored gene troopers, whose humanity was all but lost amidst an array of brutish operations worked upon their bodies and minds. They invented standard template construct machines, or STCs, that allowed human colonists to rapidly fashion what they believed to dominate new worlds and whatever natural resources they were available. They were developed sentient land weapons, worlds summoning every weapon, energy weapons, and force tanks. Fierce men of iron could be unleashed upon those who were forced to fight the war. Alien human blood, in the fashion of their tradition, is a vast land, and administered to every day of the colony worlds, transformed into glittering utopian paradises. It was during this age also that humanity's psychic evolution is said to have accelerated to the pace. And therein lay the seeds of the first human empire's annihilation. Arc historians, chronodependents, and inquisitors of the Ordo Horrendous have combed through scraps of information that exists in this era and have agreed upon two things. First, that it is impossible now to separate fact from allegory. Second, it is the first mentions of ciphers appear around the end of millennium 22, are near ubiquitous across humanity's worlds from the late millennium 23. And that absolute anarchy is said to engulf the worlds of mankind soon after. The collapse was sudden and appalling, a wave of apocalyptic catastrophe that swept across human space. Terrible wars saw entire star systems scoured of life. Armies and mechanical soldiers marched against their creators and slaughtered billions. The scourge of mutation ran rampant, and everywhere, psychic atrocities were unleashed. Everything from psychers claiming godhood over entire worlds to demonic possession and full-blown reality collapse. Then came the most ferocious warp storms that had been seen in all of mankind's history. Age of Strife, Millennium 25, Millennium 30. In the previous age had been one of prosperity and enlightenment. The Age of Strife was the start of the era. But it is hard for historians to separate fact from insane ramblings and prophecies of doom. But it appears that terrible wars raged across the length and breadth of humanity's galactic domain. Many worlds were consumed entirely, while even those whose populations endured were cut off from one another by warp storms ravaging real space. During this era of isolation and carceration, many colonies underwent drastic and widespread mutation. Some were destroyed by it, for those mutations were the result of warp energies, saturating their flesh and engulfing their worlds. Others underwent more natural processes of adaptation, transforming into abhumans, such as the augurs, the ratlings, and the stiltlings, and the beastmen. Many wondrous advances were lost or fell into despair, most of the STC technologies amongst them. Subjected to millennia of isolation, hardship, invasion, and horror, countless worlds plunged in post-apocalyptic barbarism. Amongst them was Earth itself. Legend tells how the whole world writhed in the grip of terrible wars beyond count. Techno-barbarians battled collectives of gene soldiers through the blazing ruins of once great arcologies. Cannibal savages unleashed unholy powers upon legions of cyborg zealots. Grand warlords, demigods, and proto-deities rose and fell, each one threatening to finally take the planet and its people with them into damnation. And then, in humanity's darkest hour, came the Emperor. It was he who at last healed the terrible breaches between the renamed Terra and the rebellious Mars. It was he who also led the brutal campaign known as the Unification Wars, at the head of armies of super soldiers known as the Thunder Warriors. These were the precursors of the Emperor's mighty space marine legions, and at their head of the Emperor, they cast down all rivals from the throne of Terra. Yet this was only the beginning of his endeavors. At last, the age of strife was over. Hope was restored, yet hope has ever been humanity's addiction and curse both. An age of darkness, Millennium 31. Seeking to unify not just Terra, but rather all of humanity's lost remains, the Emperor gathered his mites and launched the Great Crusade. Here was the single grandest undertaking mankind had ever done. Only one as charismatic and uncompromising as Emperor could have ever conceived a plan so far-reaching. Mighty fleets departed Terra, vast space marine legions at their head, and sweeping all resistance before them. In their wake came all the manifold agents of the Imperial compliance, ready to oppose the Emperor's secular truth upon they which taught this ignorant and fearful galaxy. It was Emperor's vision, the Great Crusade, to reclaim all the lost worlds of humanity and reunite them beneath his banner. Not only this, but all the Xeno species will be purged mercilessly from the galaxy, and all resistance to the Imperial rule will be crushed. Only this way, the Emperor claimed, could the dark tragedy of the past be prevented from occurring again. The Great Crusade swept the stars more than 100 years, pushing always outwards, bringing ever more systems and worlds in the nascent interior. Yet, the seeds of disaster were planted at the very heart of the Emperor's design. Before beginning his labors, he had fashioned the Primals, a brotherhood of alchemically engineered demigods, whose genetic material and gene seed the space marine regions was created. Before they could be truly born, however, the dark gods discovered Emperor's designs, intending to snatch away the Primarch's incubation pods and cast them adrift upon the tides of the world. Each Primarch claimed upon a different planet and scattered far and wide across humanity's ancient domains and grew to maturity amongst the people of their adopted worlds. As the Great Crusade pushed out across the stars, the Primarchs were rediscovered and repatriated into the Imperium. Each was given leadership in his legion, and their gene seed had been created. Charged to lead as the Emperor Vision dictated. It was the Emperor's favorite son, War Master Horus of the Lunar Wars. He turned first. Even as humanity stood on the brink of triumph, he was seduced by the whispers and lies of the gods, and turned in wrath upon his father's empire. Horus had led fully half of his Primarch brothers, damnation. Alongside him, plunged the Imperium into the worst civil war mankind had ever known. This dark and terrible conflict raged one end of the galaxy to the other, pitting brother against brother and space marine legion against space marine legion, until at last it was decided at the cataclysmic siege of Terra itself. It was during that final battle that the Emperor fell on Horus at last and drove his taters like a potato. I must want hash browns. Traitorous legions into exile, but not before War Master and mortally wounded his sire. So was the Emperor complying to the golden throne. So was the Emperor Imperium sundered, never to be truly whole again. So began hope's slow death. Remnants of a dark age. The Imperium of the 41st millennium is a deeply superstitious realm. Its people bound in shackles of ignorance and blinded against the dangerous truths. Atavistic terror and religious disgust characterized its attitudes and mechanic of innovation, stemming from barely remembered horrors of the dark age. Technology is but dimly understood by the mass of humanity, be they erudite scholars, military heroes, pilots of spacecraft, or rugged subs. The majority of mankind attributes the operation of technology to fickle machine spirits that must be beseeched within the proper rituals of activation and appeased with offerings of sanctified oil and sacred ungulates and the like. Only the magi and the Adeptus Mechanicus possess true repositories of technological lore. They hoard all they have gathered in towering data stacks deep within the industrial sprawls of the fortified factory plants known as the Forge Worlds. Yet even these insular priests make no distinction between technical blueprint and sacred scripture. Component holy relic. Their prayers are delivered in blaring Binharic cant. Their repairs conducted as incense wreath rituals, and their construction of the revered machines performed by rote rather than understanding. Experimentation and invention are considered tantamount to heresy. The doctrines of their machine god, the Omnissiah, grew out of terrors of the age of strife and warned of the dangers of rampant innovation. Knowledge lost in the ravages of time remains lost. For the terror of tech heresy, or at least its discovery, and the subsequent punishment, is greater by far than the dread of ignorance. For all the Adeptus Mechanicus holds vast power, which is relied upon technology to survive. There is a reason that worship of the Omnissiah is the only officially tolerated religion besides the Imperial Creed. Nor do the Adeptus Mechanicus view the acquisition of lost technologies to be in any way equivalent to the sin of fashion of the ICU. There is an irony long lost on the technicus, but they hunt rapaciously, bring the slightest fragments of ancient human artifice, many of which are examples of the very dark ancient past so reviled by the humans. Such relics of the Omnissiah are viewed as sacred treasures. Armies are readily sacrificed to ensure their acquisition. Most precious of all are the remnants of the standard template construct machines that have survived millennia. These remarkable STCs allow auto-fabrication of devices that humanity can well use in their war for survival. Many of the Imperium's most ubiquitous weapons of war are still produced in this fashion. The Imperial Creed is as damning of unsanctioned technology as it is of mutation or rebellion. Many allegorical parables warn against the horrors. Again, I must be hungry. Horrors of artificial, or horny, one of those. Hungry or unhorny, I guess. My bad. Of artificial intelligence. Kind of reminds that one character out of the sub-first game. It's a hentai game, still. Back to this. Staying focused. Do not go off topic. We had this problem in part one. Stay on one topic. We are on Warhammer. Talk about Warhammer. Guard report. And are banned even among the Adeptus Mechanicus. The average Imperial citizen views tech heresy as akin to witchcraft and reacts with equal intolerance to either. Some human worlds play host to ancient sites where the remains of Dark Age technology live. But these are shunned and cursed by those forced to live in their shadows. Xenos technology is even further distrusted. Even the most replicable and galaxy-changing innovations are typically shunned if they are of alien origin. They are exceptions, dangerous. Archaeotech finds its way to the lawless roots of hive cities or mine workings after being excavated by labor gangs. Fringe world colonists who take a more pragmatic approach to survival than most trade with neighboring Xeno species, and in so doing introduce Xenotech to the sprawling interior black markets. Such dangerous prices are sought out by various groups of the Inquisition. Of course, as are their suppliers, for the damage that these deviant forces can cause in the wrong hands does not bear a magic. Legacy of strength. The human race bears deep scars upon the collective psyche, thanks to the horrors of the Age of Strife, which ground on during the sixth millennium. Mankind survived its war ravages in only the most fragmented and desperate fashion, emerging from its shadows and into the Emperor's light. As a species, much changed. The collapse of society during this Age of Strife brought a violent end to millennia of human. Shattered the species' sense of galactic destiny. Never before had a peril or challenge human ingenuity could not best. Worse, the dangers that laid mankind low came from within, unmarked until it was too late. Damage done. The gestalt human psyche of thousands of years of dramatic catastrophe ran so deep as to become instinct, mistrust of curiosity. and invention of alien influence and psychic witchcraft predominated. Humanity became close-minded and violently conservative, desperate to avoid repetition of the mistakes that had led to the horrors of the Age of Strife, where lore and record keeping failed, and mythology and religion kept those fears alive. Perhaps that explains the fervor with which the Emperor's Great Crusade was created. Though, of course, countless warlords, isolationists, societies fought his rule, the Emperor's unification brought a safe and secular comfort that banished the ghosts haunting the human soul. If this is true, then it would also explain why the Emperor's fall saw those specters rush back in with such vengeance. Fearful and bereft, humanity sought strength in the blind zealotry of the Emperor himself. Oh. That's not the... I was trying to... Well, I know what this enemy is. I was just expecting the other guy to kill me. Actually, this is the last time I did a let's play of this game. This is actually the enemy that got to me. I just thought this enemy wouldn't trigger if there was another enemy available. Yeah, I see. I can't move. I get it. I've seen you before. I just thought the other guy was going to get me. Huh. I thought I actually had to, you know... Okay. I thought that one dude would eventually come for me. But I'm glad that that timing problem doesn't actually, you know, kill me. You spin me right round, right round, like a record, baby, right? I still say that's the Battle Kid theme. Go watch someone play Battle Kid. Can't find Ultra J-Man or Cloud8745 stuff or even Hypersonic X2 stuff, but there's Rarzar. But yeah, go type in, like, Battle Kid. I wanted to dig through the rocks. They still won't let me go backwards. Why? You know, I don't think I've died to that green guy, because I think that's the first enemy I saw when I was trying to get back to this area. I still probably should actually get back into trying to Let's Play this at some point. I actually had not played this game since I did the part that I originally got killed by that dude. And like I said, I really didn't even know, understand, like, why I originally died. This is gonna be... kind of... the first time. Because I haven't played until today, I hadn't played this game at all since I had recorded my last part of the Let's Play Spooky's Mansion playlist. So, I think it was like a month ago or something. Anyway, what happened is I got past that one area and I went further on. And it's just, I was trying to get through it okay. And I just sort of didn't know what the hell I was doing. And I kind of got a little bit lost. You know? But I managed to get past quite a few monsters. But then I got to a section of... basically, it was just a lot of loops and stuff, it looked like. But eventually I got to a point where I kind of didn't really know where the hell I was. But I kept going the whole time. But that thing that you saw kill me a moment ago was the thing that comes after you if you stay still in one spot for too long, which I didn't even know existed. But, you know, I was trying to go somewhere. I was like... though I was a bit unnerved by this guy. What? Other way. My sense of direction is terrible. Most useful spell for me. The most useful spell for me in all of Skyrim was the clairvoyance spell, just because
I get lost very easily. I apparently do not have the greatest sense of direction. But yeah, there was a while, like, I went through some tunnels and stuff, hid from this guy. And yes, I need to end the video because I'm going off topic, and I said I'd stare at Warhammer, but you know what? I was expecting this guy to come kill me. And that didn't happen, because I thought if another monster was actively trying to get me, that I was immune to that thing. And that's not the case. But that's what killed me the last time I recorded part of Spooky's Mansion. But I thought this would be a bit of ambiance, man. Here you see the guy walk by. Oh, I can actually move in here. Does he hear me moving? I didn't realize I could walk around in here. Will the one guy hear me? Why does he drop a key when he comes in? Well, I thought maybe... Let's go find him. Because I did not die to him in the past. Because I was pretty good at hiding from him. So let's just... That was the key to it. I picked up that key, right? I have a horrible sense of direction. Let's just run face first into him when we find him. I just thought it'd be kind of neat if I just, like, be just like, I thought he would just barge into the hiding spot after a while. But that wasn't the case. Where am I going? I know something. Yeah, I remember this. You have to come here. And then he's outside the door. You're supposed to hide here. But I'm not trying to do an actual let's play of this right now. I haven't played this since the last time I made the part where I got, you know, taken by the thing. Because I was running down a hallway and it just didn't seem to be moving. I was like, okay, this has got to be a trap. They're trying to trick me to look behind myself. So, I'm just going to keep going. I won't be tricked. And it turns out that I was supposed to be the opposite. When you get that situation, you're supposed to... Because that thing that killed me in the previous spot is something that's supposed to come after you if you stay still in one spot for too long. But at the same time, I feel like this guy is supposed to come closer to me a lot faster. There we go. I would say, like, oh, he's walking too slow. I'm pretty sure if you stepped out of here, he would seem to be walking kind of quick. Hi! Can I help? How good can I run away from you? You do not walk run the fastest. I can't just leap through the door. What if I hide right in plain sight? Like, hi? Because you obviously saw me hide, right? Are you gonna pull me out of here? Really? That worked? What? But he was standing. He could have maintained eye contact with me that whole time. I'm trying to remember what it was I need to get out of here. I don't remember. I know I'm paying the most attention, but I was expecting my character to die. But there's supposed to be a key in here, right? Or is it behind here? What am I remembering? There was supposed to be a key back here, right? I'm gonna have to, like, watch my video of my Let's Play to remember what the hell I need to do. I don't know how, like, with my horrible sense of direction, I managed to actually find my way around this place. You know what? Where are you? I really thought he was just gonna pull me out of there. Like, okay. Where is he? Because I feel like there was a thing I needed to grab out of that. But I really haven't been reading the notes this time around, because I wasn't trying to actually beat the game this time around. I don't remember what I did. I'm still not planning on let's playing this game again for a while. Maybe another month from now. I could have sworn there was a key in here. What did I? Cause I'm pretty sure he drops a key, right? I don't know where I'm going. I'm gonna die to that other thing because I don't know where anything is. I'm going to. Because here's the thing, I somehow found whatever the hell it was I needed to do the first time I played this, and I actually did it very quickly. Now I don't remember jack shit. How did I beat this the first time? Oh. I didn't make it to a save file. Oh, right, I had a note about going to the library. Right. You know that if you actually paid attention to what you're reading this time. There we go. For sure that's the parlor. No? Really? I have no sense of direction, guys. Somehow I managed to figure out where I was going the first time. This is still not... How am I this bad? I can't find where I'm going, or, you know, the guy trying to kill me. And again, normally you want to try to not find that. I don't know where I'm going. How the hell did I find my way the first time? Oh, this is the parlor.
You're wasting both our time.
Can I play the piano? Still interesting, all you gotta do is... Well, this is... That was unsettling! Hope everyone out there had a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful day. Bye.